I go by BJHAID everywhere on the internet, Twitter, GitHub, Stack Overflow. To slightly disappoint you, if you think I'm talking about like shipping containers to production, this is not what this talk is about. Like, but like, if you're disappointed right now, I'll try to like make you slightly excited by like, we like ship about 30,000 containers daily. We have run about an average of 11 containers per build, and like we run about 2,800 builds daily. So like this talk is more about like how we like rebuild our CI system, like powering with like Docker. So why exactly did we like choose like rebuild our CI system in at the first place? Like we had these problems. First was that like our builds were like too slow. Like the feedback cycle for like developers was like too long. They would like write code, commit it to master, and then the build would run for 2 hours like on CI, and then it would merge masters like release, and then the build would take another 2 hours like run, which means like a single commit would like take like 4 hours like get to production if they really wanted to like ship out something, an odd fix or something, which was like not great. We like builds also were like not easily reproducible. Like things would like pass on like a developer's machine, but then will fail on Jenkins. Like that wasn't like great. It also like we also were like the builds like ran, like were getting mutated by the builds themselves and like dependencies of the build. So we would see situations of things like this that, oh, the Java 7 client library like requires Java 7 JDK, but like it's getting a Java 8 JDK, so the build refuse to run because of dependencies. Or things that like, oh, Postgres seems to like being like, these are like pulled like from Slack conversations. Postgres going like a wet state on like this Jenkins machine, so I'll need to like go bounce it. Or Postgres is not even running. Like it was like all these kind of painful experiences made us like say in spring of this year we really wanted to like get head on this and like fix these problems. So we came up with like very simple objectives. First was that we wanted to make the builds like way faster. We wanted to like make the builds like reproducible. We also wanted to like make the builds like host agnostic, so you could like build on any Unix machine and it'll run on any Unix machine. So we went on an adventure. This is actually my colleague James who actually went on this adventure. He went on this adventure trying to like go get a discovery, and he discovered Docker. Like, so why is Docker like suited to like all these problems that we faced, like all these problems that we're trying to like solve? A brief about like things that are nice about Docker. Docker has like this image slash Docker file inheritance. So you could say from like this base image, I want to like build off of this image and like do all these X number of things and then create a new image. Docker also like supports image level caching. So if application A depended on image X and application B depends on image X, if application A runs first on this machine and pulls down image X, and application B runs next, Docker will say, oh, I see that like this image exists locally, so I would like not pull this image. Or if application A, like, if application X was just built on this machine and application A depends on application X, Docker will say, oh, I saw that like this thing has been built previously, I would not like try pulling it, which is like very great for like making things fast. Docker also like reuses layers even across like images. So if a layer exists in like image X, if Docker notices that, oh, this shard some of this image, like, a layer exists in image X and image Y actually needs like that same shard sum, it would not pull that thing from like registry, instead just reuse like the layer that exists in like image X. Or if you need to like do a push, it would like say, oh, I know the registry has this layer, so I would like not push this layer. Instead, I'll just like ignore that part, which is like very great for like making things fast. Docker is like portable across machines, so you could like build your image like on a Fedora box and like run it on an Ubuntu box, which is like fine. And Docker is like widely adopted on like alternatives like to like Docker. They don't have like as much adoption as Docker is. So it was easy for us to just pick Docker and say, oh, this already like means that like if we run into problems, like people are like most likely would have seen the same problems that we're going to run into and we can like just leverage on their solutions and like run with it. So we decided to like put Docker to use. We heavily leveraged on like Docker's inheritance between images and Docker files. So we help with like this kind of tree. This is like a very minimal representation of a very complex tree that we run at Braintree. You will start with like the base image, which is like the WYSIWYG base. Everything specific to all Braintree application lives in that WYSIWYG base. We actually have a couple of other bases. We have like Jesse, and for those who run Alpine, we have like an Alpine base image. And then everything specific to like Braintree lives inside of that like base image. Then you have like services, like RabbitMQ, Redis, Postgres. They all like have things specific to that service that lives inside of their images. Then languages, we now like have language specific images. So like Ruby 2.3 would like have a Ruby, things are specific only Ruby 2.3 and such Ruby 1.9, Java, Node, Elixir, and things like that. And then applications will now like say, oh, I would like leverage off of the base image of the language itself, and everything that all my dependencies are specific to like the language itself, I would like now like put all the dependencies of this app inside the application's base image. So like application A, for example, will now like depend on application A base image, and then all the app get installed dependencies and bundle install in some cases will like live inside of that base image. Then your builds will now run inside A, which will just be your code that keeps on changing. And we like structure this in such a way that like each time anything changes in the top of the hierarchy, the entire part of that tree is like completely built. Like we like design it so that it's built, and we build this thing weekly. So if you don't like pin versions of dependencies, you get almost like the most recent version of your dependency, like sometimes in a week, which is like great for us. So like we also like run our registry to like make all this thing like really work. We actually run our own registry. We started with like running an EC2 registry just only in EC2, but then we have our Jenkins master and a couple of Jenkins workers actually run in our physical data center or in one of our physical data centers. And my problem is we started noticing like the cost of a round trip to like S3 and EC2 was like very expensive for us. So we started to like spin up like a new pool of registries in like our physical data center. They all like communicate with the same S3 backend as the one that runs in EC2. But we like add a layer of like caching. So we do like caching in like Nginx. So the first time like you do like a pool from either like a developer's physical development machine or from like a Jenkins worker, it would say, oh, Jenkins would say, Nginx would say, oh, I don't know about this layer, so I'm going to go ahead and talk to like the registry. And once the first time he does that, subsequent request, Nginx would say, oh, I know about this layer, so I would like not even like send this request. That like completely like we do it just once and we don't do it again, which kills like all the requests that we keep sending to S3, makes things way faster for us and like make things better. And we like do SSL termination and load balancing. We actually use source IP load balancing, so you'd always like talk to the same registry that you like talk to the first time. We do the load balancing from true HA proxy, which like made things like way better than it was like, cause at some point it was like very painful for us, like pools and pushing. Well, pools were like became very expensive, but like because we are heavily pool based, like you see further down the line why we're heavily pool based, but like because we're heavily pool based, we have to like do set up this registry in our physical data center. So what's our build flow like? We start with like building the image, which like becomes like the image I showed at the leaf of the tree from like two slides earlier. We spin up a container and run specs inside it. So like if the specs passes, we like see the database. So if this is like our primary application, we'll go ahead and like see the database and like prepare it for commit the project itself, do a Docker commit and of the project and database image. We now tag, we do a double tagging of our images. We tag first with like the application git sha, and then we tag with like the branch, with the whatever branch that we're running off of. So you can like, a build downstream can say, oh, or even a human downstream, a human can say, oh, given this metadata, which is probably like the git sha, I want the registry to provide me with like the image that matches this like git sha, and it will like go ahead and provide it for you because that's how we tag. Or like I just want like the most recent master build of this thing. You can just request for the most recent master build. And we do like the same thing with our database. We compute an MD5 sum of all the files like are involved in like generating this seed for the database. And then we like use that to like tag the database itself and do a master or whatever branch tagging, because we run a couple of branches. Do a branch tagging also for like the database, and like we now like push the project, do a Docker push of the project and database image, and then we trigger downstream build. So like for like our core application, it ends up triggering over 100 builds based off of this, and means that, oh, once we like build this thing once, those builds can just rely on it, which was like the part that was like very painful for like things like our client library builds. Our client library builds depends on like four or five different applications, but each of them previously would like do a database migration and see the database, each of them for each of them, and a build that should like take 5 minutes would like run for over 50 minutes and not like complete. So like early results of this work itself was that, sorry, our builds are very reproducible based on like the way we tag our builds, tag our images. You could, if something fails on CI, you could confidently say, I can actually pull down this image that actually failed on CI, and I can run it on my machine, and I'm guaranteed that like I can completely reproduce the failure. Our builds were significantly faster. Like we took down, see, this graph actually shows like what the average time in speed was like in minutes for like builds on the old CI and the new CI. The red line, the red bars there shows the old CI, the green bars there shows the new CI, and this was like significant, immediate significant benefits that was like very obvious that like this was like the right way to go. So given this is like, given this success, if this was just, oh, probably my talk would just end here. But then like, good things don't come easy. We achieved the objectives, but like, it came with other problems. We were like dicey chaining Docker files, make files. We would have like this make file invoking that make file, invoking that make file. And then we would have inside our compose files, extend. And then you would end up with like five or different compose files. And we're also like duplicating things across compose files. So because application A depends on application C, B, C, D, E, F, it would copy everything that we've written. We'll have to copy everything that we've written in B, C, D, E, F into A. So it was like spin up like the images for like all those images as dependents for this build, which was like insane. Like it was a very bad user experience for us, and we are going to actually deliver this like the old dev team in Braintree, which was like going to be, we obviously knew we were going to get a serious pushback. Like people would like not really want to like do this thing. So we decided to like, it was like this, it looked like this. It was a big bag of candy with all sorts of things inside of it. So we decided to like make things better. We came up with like a new objective. We wanted to replace this dicey chain with just something better. So we decided to like write a DSL. Write a DSL that will replace compose files and make files. The DSL was written in a language that is like a lingua franca of every Braintree developer, Ruby. Every Braintree dev should and is able to like write Ruby. It's heavily inspired by Rake. It's extendable in Ruby because it's written in Ruby. A reduced and removed duplication. Removing duplication is your choice in almost any language. So like, but it helps you like completely reduce the duplication that we like go into previously. And the DSL actually looks like this. So this actually maps like compose, the concepts in compose. You say service Postgres, it has like this image. It says I require this, I use this image as like my image to spin up any container. Then it says service sample app, it uses this image. Then your job description is actually the meat of the thing. Your job description specifies, oh, I depend on sample app and Postgres. And I want, like, the body of the job is any Ruby code, actually. Any Ruby code there will work. So you could actually even invoke your shell directly from there. And then you say sample app links to, like, Postgres, but then with the alias sample app DB, it has this environment variable Postgres host, which points to, like, sample app DB. It has this environment Postgres port, which points to 5433. Then it has this compose command called rake. It will create a compose object and do a run on it. That will, like, just like translate to this Docker compose file, except that like you can, it would like, once you look at the tool itself is called Drake. Once you do Drake test, it would just go ahead and like run, do a Docker compose run. Like it would imitate what you would have done with like Docker compose run sample app with like this compose file. So like you wonder what exactly is fancy about like this thing? Why, how does this like make things better than using just a compose file? Well, let's go to like a slightly more complex example. So I introduced a new concept here called application. Application here refers to like this previous application I just showed in like two slides earlier that defines that Drake file. It says that like application that and I'm specifying like I'm in this namespace called sample app. You can find me in like this local path, sample app, but if you don't find me there, I could exist in this remote path, which is this remote path here. And I want you to always like use this revision, which is final here. You can always dynamically via Ruby to like define whatever revision you want there. And then it says that I am also defining this service called foo and specifying this image. Now, in the job itself here, you could have n number of jobs inside actually what we call the Drake file here. You could also have like n number of services. It doesn't restrict you. And you could write Ruby code inside of it. I said valid Ruby code. So you say job test here depends on sample app from the sample app namespace, and it depends on Postgres from the sample app namespace. It also depends on foo that we just defined inside our own namespace here. And it says foo links to like sample app from the sample app namespace, aliased as sample app, and then links to like Postgres from the sample app namespace, aliased as Postgres. And the compose command is rake. You create a compose object and you do a run on it. It like equates like this same thing here. Also, will like give you this nicety of like saying you have this Drake host user ID inside of like your container, so you can like tell who exactly is the user that actually runs the daemon itself, or ran the binary itself. I would explain further later why like we added this, and like this is like useful for you down the line. So like given this thing, we've been able to like power ourselves to, like actually create complex builds like this. We'll be able to like write very complex jobs like this. This is actually our European application here. Like until we actually wrote this thing, like it was almost impossible to actually write a job that actually like fully exercised our entire European flow, application flow. So like we actually simulate the reality of exactly what happens in production with like this job itself. And this spins up like 22 containers. It equates like these 221 lines of compose file. And like for brevity, I just like reduce like the content of like the compose file, and it like if you draw like a graph of the links, this is like what it looks like. So this is actually what it shows like the complexity of like the job itself, and we're able to like power even like more complex jobs. People have written more complex things after discovering this in Braintree, which is like based off of like the power of like the TSL that we've written. Also, we are applying to open source it, so in case you ask that question. So let's talk about the things that surprised us with like Docker. Like this is like a documented behavior, but it's like a very annoying, surprising behavior. Like if directory doesn't exist in like your file system, and you do a Docker compose run something specifying this directory as a volume and telling it to like mount like this point on like this container. Instead of Docker just freaking out and saying, "Oh, I don't know of this directory," Docker would silently ignore like that failure, create that directory in the local path, and then like mount it. Let me just show you an example. So we run ls there as a start there, like, and see that the directory is completely empty. We do a Docker run volume specifying a directory that doesn't exist on the local path, and then saying that it should mount this directory B that does not exist to A, and then just run a simple like bash here, bin bash here. Docker will go ahead and like not freak out here. Docker will just like silently like create these things for you. Now you check A actually exists inside of the container itself. You can write things into A inside of the container, which is like interesting. You check that you write things inside of A into the container, and like it allows you write things, like you write things there and it's fine. And then you get out of the container and now do like an ls inside of the container. LS inside of the directory from outside, and you see that this directory has actually been created. It's been created as root, which is like even makes it even worse, and it's written things into it as root, so you can't actually even remove this. This was like very, very painful for us because like we do mount like volumes for like JUnit output for like to render our test results in like Jenkins UI, because so like this was like very painful for us. Like, so the tip is that like if you really want to use volumes, make sure like the user ID or the group ID like matches like the user ID or group ID inside of like the user ID running the daemon matches the user ID or group ID of the user that runs inside of the container. Otherwise, you run all sorts of problems with, like, volumes. Or you resort to, like, tricks that we resorted into because we had gone far down the line before we realized this. In our, like, Wheezy base, we actually had that first line where we actually, because we manage our users and groups with Puppet, so we can tell, like, that, like, the group will always, the Docker group will always be 918 everywhere, and you cannot run the Docker daemon if you don't belong to the Docker group. And they will now put that umask there. Also, sadly, there's no way. All the standard tricks to setting umask in Linux doesn't work with Docker. There's an open issue that, like, we're trying to, like, convince people are trying to convince the Docker team to, like, expose it so that you can set the flag to, like, set umask. But you have to, like, explicitly set umask and do all these things so that the user itself that run, so that, like, one, either the container crashes or the user that ran the thing can actually do a correct cleanup. Because all Jenkins will also, like, try to do a git clean DFX, and that would, like, fail. So, like, that was, like, very painful for us. So this is actually, like, a feature that surprises me. It's a feature that I don't understand. If you do, like, Docker Compose, okay, so let me show you an example of this. So given this very simple Compose file, like, foo depends on, sorry, this is too fast. Given this Compose file, foo links, like, Redis, and then you now do, like, a Docker Compose run foo. Compose will, like, do the right thing here and start Redis and then start foo. Now you do a Docker Compose stop PS, and you see both of them are running. You do a Docker Compose stop, and you expect, what do you expect? You expect it to stop both of them, right? But Docker Compose will surprise you. It will stop Redis and do nothing. So foo is still running. Docker Compose foo PS, it knows foo is still running, it knows Redis is stopped, and then you now do, like, okay, I want to be very harsh here. I do the forceful removal. It removes just Redis, ignores foo. Now you do a Docker Compose PS and you still see that foo is still running. So you have to, like, really bring out the tough sledgehammer here from Docker itself and, like, forcefully remove everything here. Like, forcefully remove everything. This was, like, this is, like, very surprising, and, like, it's, like, it took us a while to actually figure this out. We kept finding, like, it will fail that, like, names had been chosen and things like that. Like, and yeah, it took us a while to figure this out. So with every project, there's always, like, a very painful experience. Like, these ones don't qualify as surprising. They are painful because they want to cause a while to, like, figure out the solutions and, like, or even figure out where exactly was wrong for some of them. So we ran into, like, this, sometimes around, like, March, we ran into, like, these transient networking problems where, like, randomly builds would just, like, either hang or fail with, like, a TCP timeout. We'll hop on this box and we'll see it's, like, on trying to, like, make a TCP, the S3C process, and see that it's on trying to, like, make a TCP connection. We would, like, manually make this connection and the connection will work fine, but then the process itself can't make a connection, or it would time out making that connection. And this kept happening, like, very intermittently. Like, it wasn't, like, in a predictable pattern. We, like, Googled and see, has anyone run into this problem? But then we found one issue that someone opened and almost closed immediately, like, oh, I can't sufficiently reproduce this problem and I've not, like, seen it again or something. So we, like, trying to trace back exactly what exactly happened and how did this actually happen. We found that, like, this actually correlated with when we started saying, oh, we really want to make something super fast, when we started, like, preloading our AMIs and VMs, like, images. So, like, these images already existed and, like, our jobs had to do lesser things, like, once it started running. And once we completely stopped, like, preloading these AMIs and loading with, like, so many images and busting our caches every day. So every day we, like, do a Docker RMI, all the images, delete everything Docker, and then restart Docker again, like, every day. Once we started, like, busting our caches, all of this just, like, completely disappeared. We also ran into, like, random kernel problems. Like, we ran into, like, this was, like, very annoying that, like, the crash jumps that we were getting from the kernel crashes were not, like, you couldn't correlate them. We would find Xen-related things and Docker-related things, but really we couldn't, like, correlate. Like, you'll get a crash jump today here and get a different crash jump today, tomorrow there. And then, like, we ran different versions of Xen host. We ran different versions of Xen. We still, like, saw these problems, like, replicating themselves. So, like, almost every kernel problem I faced, like, in my career, the thing you always resort to first is that, oh, let me actually run the most recent Linux kernel and see, does that fix it? So like 2 months ago, we pulled down 3.18.36, which was like most recent stable at that time, patched with UFX and compiled it, and like the problems just magically disappeared. So it's probably something fixed in a mainline kernel, yeah. And thank you for like listening to me. Special thanks to like my teammate there, my colleague. We worked on this, like, and a couple of people who are not here. We worked on this and like saw this through. And questions?
Yeah. Woohoo!
Hi, thank you for your presentation. A quick question: you mentioned that you guys made the custom DSL. What was the process evaluating writing the DSL versus patching Docker Compose?
So
one more DSL adds another layer of on top of it. I was curious the process.
So someone actually went on one weekend and actually spiked this in Racket in just one weekend. So and like we felt like we were good enough to like do it in 1 week or two if we could like invest the time in it. So we like we had 4 people on the team, and we sacrificed a pair to like continuously work on this for like a week. And after a week, they came up with like a proof of concept that was like very interesting. And like the second week, it was like completely polished.
So you mentioned you were using AUFS, is that correct?
Yeah.
Had you considered any other union file systems, or was AUFS like the only thing that?
So because this is not production, like we like choose the simplest things like get the job done.
Just as a follow-up, how did you deal with persistent volumes when you were dealing with stuff like databases? Is that something where you basically rebuild the database on every deploy? Or?
So first is that like we do it not like the – so we don't use persistent volumes. We like put everything inside of the image and push the image because this is just like – we want to like just like do things once and reuse it, right? So we push it so that like people can just like – humans or builds can like refer to this MD5 sum tag to like pull whatever they want, and not like we also wanted to make it so that like it could run anywhere independent of like so using persistent volumes meant that you had to restrict where the build could run.
You seem to be building a lot of Docker images. How do you handle data retention? How do you get all these images cleaned up that you don't need anymore so the registry doesn't fill up like crazy?
Okay, well, this is a discussion that crops up once in a while, and like we have not like solved this problem. It's in S3, and we have for now thought of S3 as an infinite pool of like space until we really need to like we've kicked the can down the road. That's just a simple answer.
Infinite space, I like that. Any other questions? Okay. Is this your first conference talk?
Yeah, this is my first conference
call. Give it up! Yeah!
Thank you.